On behalf of Craft Revival Trust and the India International Center, I welcome our chief guest, His Excellency Mr. Prasad Kariyawasama, High Commissioner of Sri Lanka. I also welcome our speaker, Mr. Tilak Samarawickrame, architect, artist, and designer from Sri Lanka. I welcome Dr. Kapilavatsyan. Thank you so much for being here, Ashok Chatterjee, and I extend a warm welcome to everybody else who's braved the cold of Delhi and the traffic to be with us here today. Thank you for being here. This talk today is part of the Craft Revival Trust long-term audience engagement program, Putting Ideas First, that seeks to bring to the table information and discussion on cultural heritage, livelihoods, policy, and all that lies between. Today, we are also taking the opportunity to launch Tilak Samarawickrame's latest publication, A Voyage in Sri Lankan Design. This publication captures his prolific body of work in architecture, art, crafts, and design over the past 40 years. It includes his contribution to the arts and crafts of Sri Lanka in the 1980s, documents his creation of his hand-woven tapestries, and provides a window into his drawing style that resonates with Sinhalese calligraphy. The publication also includes his architectural explorations and much more in a many-faceted professional life. The book is published by Vijitha Yapa, who is also present here from Sri Lanka, and distributed in India by Roli Books. I would now request Tilak to please present a copy of his books to his Excellency. His Excellency will say a few words.
Madam Ritu, Mr. Tilak Samarawickrame, Excellencies, distinguished guests here, as a diplomat, or career diplomat of Sri Lanka, I feel humbled by this audience who are, I think, more in tune with art, culture, design, and I will just share a few thoughts as a first remark, so that we can give more time to Tilak to talk about very important person in our region, Mr. Ananda Kumara Swami. I think those who are here, all of you perhaps aware of his contribution to South Asian revival and rediscovery of South Asian tradition, South Asian art, South Asian craft, and South Asian thinking. And of course, there are people here like Madam Kapilavatsyan who had equally contributed equal measure to that tradition. And sometimes we in South Asia celebrate, or we have idols and heroes, a lot of them sometimes in many fields, in politics, in art, and also perhaps in cricket today. But there are unsung heroes in our culture and our system. I believe Ananda Kumaraswamy is one of them. I am little doubtful how much of the current generation know about his contribution throughout his lifetime to bring out primarily to the Western world the value and the essence of the South Asian heritage and culture, which and in an effort to portray that it is not inferior, or in fact it is sometimes superior to what is Western, that was perhaps came upon us due to colonial expansion. These are my thoughts. Some of you may agree or disagree, but I just thought want to share them. And in that context, I think celebration of life of people like Ananda Kumaraswamy is very important, because I feel he's an unsung hero. And today, of course, Tilak Samarawickrame is an architect, a designer, art historian, and I would In my view, he is both a traditionalist and a modernist, and has had the capacity to merge these two traditions in such a manner that you bring out the best in both. And his work is reflected in this his latest book, and it encapsulates to some extent what Sri Lanka has produced and has become. And he has, of course, exercised not only his professional competence with social responsibility, providing opportunities for many rural craftsmen to show their skills and to bring out essence of that quality. And I think we are, therefore, I would like to thank Tilak for and Craft Revival Trust India for making this opportunity for us to listen to Tilak about Ananda Kumara Swami, and also for us to enjoy his book, which I think is an excellent catalog of not only his lifetime work, but a reflection of Sri Lanka, what Sri Lanka has offered. Of course, as we know, Sri Lanka has derived immensely from Indian culture, Indian history, and Indian. But of course, over 2,500 years, we have also created our own uniqueness in our culture and our art and craft, and that is also reflected in this publication. And at a time when everything is going electronic, and even today I got an email from High Commissioner for Human Rights saying that hereafter only greetings will be from electronically, no more cards will be sent to preserve paper. So I believe these books of this nature will become collector's items soon, because there won't be books to first read, because everything is going electronic today. But I am one of those who like to read books rather than read on the screen. So I treasure this book, and without much ado, I thank you very much. And I think I took too long time, because you are here to listen to him, not to me. Thank you very much. Thanks, all of you.
Yes, Dr. Kapila.
Your Excellency and other Excellencies, the author of the book and the title of the lecture, A Tribute to A.K. Kumara Swami. I would swim the English Channel to go and listen to anyone who speaks about A.K. Kumara Swami. And I just taking this opportunity not to intervene between the valuable words of His Excellency and the speaker, but only to underline most emphatically that Kumara Swami's role in this century is unique. Yes, he belonged to Sri Lanka, a DG of geology, and as Tilak would know, his first book begins with the arts and crafts of Ceylon, and I address the craft society here. That's where he began to look at material, from geology to the crafts. And then this long journey into the metaphysical traditions of the East. And we have to bear in mind this generation and Kumara Swami, who took on the likes of a Birdwood and many other people, and as His Excellency has rightly said, were the art of this country, or this, whether it was Sri Lanka or India, was not considered anything to be taken into cognizance. And we have to pay homage to this leader of ideas. And I speak here only because I could not resist paying a tribute to one whom I consider not only my Gyan Guru, but a Gyan Guru of a whole generation of art historians, philosophers, thinkers, and his connection with the European rediscovery with Eric Gill and those sitting in Egypt, and that remarkable book, The Life of Art and Life. So please forgive me for intervening, which I don't, I come to listen. But this is an occasion where I think that South Asia, Indonesia, East Asia owes a deep, deep debt to the son of Sri Lanka, who was literally global. Thank you.
Tilak, if I could request you to start your lecture, and we will take questions at the end. Thank you.
So this is the Indian launch of my book, A Voyage in Sri Lankan Design, Art, Craft, Architecture. I have dedicated this book to Anand Kumar Swami and the craftspeople of Sri Lanka. I am what I am today thanks to Anand Kumar Swami and his historical documentation of the arts and crafts of our country, medieval Sinhalese art. As a hungry architectural student, way back in the 60s, I discovered Kumar Swami and the book, Medieval Sinhalese Art. I normally have a problem reading books, and I tend to read the visual narrative of books, and there are very few books I have read, and I just mention a few. As a student of architecture, I read the medieval Sinhalese art not once, twice or thrice, Corbusier's Towards a New Architecture. And of course, for architects, the Bible, which skips my mind the name, anyway, it will come later. So, and the Bauhaus, you know, those are the books I read as an architectural student. And whilst working in the renowned Sri Lankan architects' office, Jeffrey Bawa, I began a doodling habit, which quickly I realized was more than a doodle. And maybe I was a great Jeffrey Bawa fan as a student, but later on, maybe I was getting bored with the vernacular aesthetic, and I was more interested in what Renzo Piano and Richard Rogers were doing at Centre Pompidou, constructing what they were doing with tubular steel, you know, sculptural architecture with tubular steel. So anyhow, very soon, I won a scholarship to Italy, you know. And apart from doing a dissertation on the a comparative study of the Greek Agora and the Roman Forum as part of our art history program, I didn't know that much of so much about Italy either, you know, though I was fascinated by the medieval town centers, etc. The only book I found was Alberto Moravia's The Woman of Rome. So, anyhow, I got a taste of this eternal city of Rome through Moravia's Woman in the Book, you know, and due to strange karmic factors, I spent 10 years of my life in this city of Rome. My scholarship took me to Milan, to the Milan Polytechnic. And I forgot to tell you that I left Sri Lanka with Ananda Kumar Swami's medieval Sinhalese art, my line drawings, and $5. That's all they let us take during that time from out of Sri Lanka. So the medieval Sinhalese art has traveled with me all over, from Italy to New York and back to Italy. And then I still refer to Kumar Swami's book, Medieval Sinhalese Art. In Milan, which in the 70s was the industrial pulse of the industrial design world and the fashion capital, I had the privilege of meeting Bruno Munari, an iconic figure, renowned Italian designer, the author of Design as Art. And I went to his home, and I had my drawings with me. And the moment he looked at my drawing and he realized I was from Sri Lanka, he ran into the house and brought out a Ola leaf manuscript, a gift he had just received from a friend who had visited Sri Lanka. And he said this to me: "We have a lot to learn from your part of the world." You know, here's a man who was... I was in my mid-20s and he was in his 50s virtually, you know. And we became great friends, and right up to his death, we were very close. And he wrote many of my exhibition catalogs, from line drawings to tapestries. There's quite a similarity. I mean, Ananda Kumar Swami was a cultural philosopher, Munari too was a cultural philosopher. You know, they had a big exhibition 2 months ago in London, where the New York Times, you know, had one whole page on him. I mean, he was a visionary. Of course, he was a designer. You know, he was a great designer and writer too. You know, he wrote this book, Design as Art, which was translated into almost 30 languages. And my tribute to Ananda Kumar Swami is through my work, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I don't intend to, already ambassador and madam have spoken of Kumar Swami, and I would pay tribute to him. My way of paying tribute to him is through my work and through this book. So, let me begin. This is a slide from my own home, which has a lacquered Buddhist stupa, which was done in the 80s when I was a design consultant to the National Design Center. And behind it is a wire sculpture of mine, line drawing turned into wire sculptures. And at the back is a recent tapestry. And the stool has also been designed by me. So I round it up with this image, what the book is about. Now, this is the introduction to my book. I took it off a catalog of mine, which Bruno Munari has written, and he begins. I'm not going to read the entire thing, but to most people, tradition is something that remains behind us. a heritage that we need to preserve. They say one works according to tradition. Tradition is a consummation of memory, of rules, a way of being, and the manner of expression that is passed on from one generation to another. If one merely repeats the rules of the old tradition, it is not in keeping with memory. It remains rooted in the past without participating in the present. A tradition is something that is not considered behind us, but within us, in our thinking, in our way of being, and our expression. And the last paragraph, he's talking about me, but I'll skip that. In this manner, a new generation emerges with a tradition. A new product is born that continues to have roots in the history of that place, but at the same time becomes a symbol of the new generation in the field of decorative and visual arts. Hence the traditions that do not remain behind us, but within us, produces out of us new signs and new aesthetic orders. So, even Anand Kumar Swami's thinking was on these lines, I believe. You know, I mean, to him, tradition is a evolving. He believed in an evolving tradition, you know, and it is not a craft object to be placed in a museum, you know, well documented, well codified, placed in a museum. It's a living tradition. So in that sense, you know, there's a parallel between these two great people, you know, in their thinking, you know, and here's the difference is Munari is a great designer, you know. I mean, he wrote about 40 books on design, you know, and so that's the only difference, that he himself was a designer, you know. Well, now we go to a wall painting from 1786 from a Buddhist temple. I mean, I didn't purposely look at that wall painting and do this hand-woven tapestry. During whilst I was trying to put together this book, I came across this photograph, which I had taken myself about 2 years ago. So I thought it would be nice to place the two together, you know. I mean, the subconscious maybe, you know, source of inspiration, color-wise, etc. These are ceramic plates designed by me, produced in Sri Lanka. Now, I was an ILO consultant to the National Design Center when I returned from Sri Lanka from Italy in 1983 after spending 12 long years. What I absorbed and observed in Milan especially, you know, I felt one day I might be able to apply it to my own country. So I got this opportunity in 1986 to do a rapid craft development program at the National Design Center. So this is part of the lacquer work we did. And this again, a traditional stupa form, you know, in lacquer, giving it a slightly modern sort of feel. But at the same time, in our Damuvilla cave temple, you know, we have colored stupas, you know. These are sculptural toys I designed for Magnaform in New York. Again, inspired by Kumar Swami's book, where there are drawings of Sri Lankan chieftains. And these two were produced in Sri Lanka. After I left the design center, just after a year or less than a year, I opened my own crafts gallery. This is an interior view of. For 4 years, I ran it in my own home. and this is what it looked like. So these are the mat weavers. Sri Lankan handicraft is synonymous with the mat weavers, Dumbara mat weavers of Henavala. And I interacted with them during my stint at the design center. And this is the chief weaver. I mean, he was the chief weaver from the village. There were 70 families weaving in that village at that time in 1986. And we introduced new designs, some inspired by the mural painting tradition of Sri Lanka. So this is a Dumbara mat inspired by some of the mural paintings of Sri Lanka. This is a juxtaposition of various mats we produced and designed. I mean, this is totally different to what they were traditionally doing, you know. This is another collection of Dumbara mats that were designed by us. Some have traditional motifs, some not. Then we took a olive leaf manuscript with deity figures on it from the Kandy Museum and blew them up and took it to the village and got them to weave. I mean, they were exquisite weavers, you know. I mean, they were masters at what they were doing. And they brought out something very close to, you know, the details on the Dumbara, on the olive leaf manuscripts. But I must also say this. They said they'll never ever weave again these mats because they have to sit on the mat to weave. And they didn't want to do it. You know, they just did it. But they did it only once because they didn't want to sit on the Buddha whilst weaving. Neither did they want to sit on the other deities. And this is Lapia at my Kalambu book launch, and he's 76 years old. Just amazing guy. He stayed with us that night, and he came home, and we have a coffee table with lots of books on design and art, etc. You know, I have relatives coming, sitting there for hours. Nobody takes any notice, but this man went through all those books. It's just amazing, you know. I mean, you know, one by one he picked up a book and went through them, you know. I mean, I was just, you know, amazed, you know, how curious he was. This is a village of women potters that was written up in the London Guardian, you know. I will go to the Potter village. This was the height of the war at that time. And it ends with luck and Samaravikram's hard work. When they are no longer potters by birth, some of them will think it worthwhile to be potters by choice. She is P.S. Ely, you know, the head of that cooperative. On a field trip where we were going around craft villages, we saw a large earthenware pot in front of an Ayurvedic dispensary, and then we inquired where this pot came from, and then we were told that it came from this particular village close by. And this is a village, you know, and P.S. Ely comes from that village, and they are all women potters, you see. Men fetch the clay, and at that time there were 10 women, you know, making pots. And after at a later stage, I managed to get them build a roadway across the paddy fields and through CEDA, the Canadian fund, so that they can take their Landmaster tractor to the village. Otherwise, they would have earlier they were carrying the clay, you know, across the paddy fields. And this is the lady. This was 1986-87. This is a great success story, ladies and gentlemen. You know, they were having a very difficult time in 1986 when we met them to market their products. And there were 10 of them, 10 potters, women potters. And today, in 2012, they have become extremely successful, the village, and there are 15 women throwing the wheel today, and this lady herself, Pia Seeley, I mean they were as romantic as they could be. I mean this is the type of house they lived in. But the entire village have now proper, I mean, I wouldn't say, they have constructed houses with tile roofs, proper toilets, and this Pia Seeley herself has a large three-bedroom house. They own a lorry and a Landmaster tractor. And they have excellent business, you know, I mean, each family unit. Is an entrepreneur unit of on their own, and they do their own business. So it's just an amazing success story, which I think I contributed in a very modest way at the inception. And we invited her. This is the this is Sarath Namanugama, the Deputy Minister of Finance. Someone I knew when he was not a politician. He even visited me in Rome. So, Pia Seeley was supposed to come to my place at 3 o'clock on the day of the launch. As she didn't arrive, I called them. And she said the event was the next day, she thought. And she had her daughter had stitched a new blouse and brought a new sari. But nevertheless, she had no time. She just wrapped a sari and rushed to Colombo in 2.5 hours to be present there. So, this is her receiving this copy of the book. But unfortunately, they all lamented that the book is in English, you know. So, I mean, they were very, very, even the other weaver was, you know, very sad that the book, you know, is in English. My publisher is here. And I hope we can come out with a Sinhalese version of the book, edition of the book. This is another sculptor we worked with during my design center stint. And we sent him to Polonnaruwa to look at the Galvihara complex, the unique rock cut sculptural Buddha statues. These are reclining Buddha. There's a seated Buddha and a standing Buddha. And he drew a lot of inspiration from what he saw in Polonnaruwa. And this is what he carved on his return and kept producing for many years. They are some of the most exquisite Buddha statues I have seen. Sadly, is no more with us. So I invited his sons to receive a book in his father's honor. Brass work brass was the other area we worked with. The design center had a workshop in Kandy in a crafts village, and these are the products. they produced. This is Sinhala alphabet etched onto a gift box. We also revived waning craft traditions by giving them new designs. I'll run through it fast. This is another mat weaving section. She's in her 90s today, and she was the main supervisor and the weaver at the National Design Center. And these are some of the mats we got them to weave. They had never done this sort of thing. This sort of design detail, no method of weaving, but they are highly skilled weavers. And these are some of the contemporary designs they did, they produced, you know. And these are the three of the weavers who worked with me way back in the 80s. They're still with the National Design Center. I even had to go visit some of their homes and bring them to Colombo, and they felt quite honored to be there that evening and receive this a copy of the book. Now this is the village I continue to work with to date. This is the oldest weaving village in Sri Lanka. They were weaving for time immemorial, and he's the master weaver of Talagune Udadumbara. I couldn't find them during my stint at the National Design Center because they were tucked away off the beaten track, and once I returned from Guatemala, having worked with Mayan Indian weavers, I went looking for them. And in 1990, I began a collaboration with this village. This is Srisena and his three sons. They were all weavers. And I'm proud to say that within 2 years of our interaction and collaboration, I managed to take this product from this remote village in the Candian district of Sri Lanka to the MoMA Design Store in New York on 53rd Street, and they carried it for 8 years. These are the three sons. Now, I was doing the, you know, I wanted to change the aesthetics of my tapestry design, and 2 years ago, I looked at the color palette which they had brought, woven color palette, and it was hung on the wall. And then suddenly I realized, you know, here is a new direction, and with this began a new aesthetic order, you know. And the direction changed, though we still continue to do the older ones. So we came out with this new aesthetic. These are some of the older pieces. I have also, in Switzerland, Langenthal, Switzerland, they did a collection of my carpets, woolen floor carpets. These were the designs. And this is a designer Saturday in Langenthal, where you can see on the wall the two carpets I had designed. This is Sirisena, the master weaver from Talagune. And that's his son. How much time have I got? Yeah, okay. There are so many stories about this. Yeah. No, this is my tribute to Ananda Kumar Swami, ladies and gentlemen. This is my last exhibition in New Delhi at Gallery Art Motif. This is transfer of the tapestry aesthetic to fashion. Now here we have taken motifs from medieval Sinhalese art and reworked it out in contemporary design. And this is my way of paying tribute to Ananda Kumar Swami, ladies and gentlemen. These are my line drawings. The Sinhalese alphabet. These are wire sculptures. My line drawings turned into wire sculptures. The tapestry is deconstructed, turned into animation, digital animation. This is an animated film I did in Italy on a Sri Lankan folk tale. And this is my latest production for the T20 World Cup. And now we come to my architecture. I'll run through quickly.
If there are any questions, the floor is now open. The photographs that you showed us, it didn't mention where they were.
There was no time.
Yeah, I know. So could you just tell us a little? Pardon me? They're all in Sri Lanka. So there's beautiful usage of skylights I noticed in a few of them.
These are all factories?
Yes. I mean, those big buildings were all factories. And there was one, a green factory, the last one. I mean, there's no time, you know.
Yeah, I've understood that. That's why I'm asking you this question. Yeah. So they were all, these are all factories.
Factories and residences and hotels.
Mr. Tilak, I wanted to know if you have designed, you said that tradition is an evolving concept. So have you redesigned the Buddhist pagodas, places of worship in your sculpture and your other motifs you have shown, but in actual, the new places of worship, I mean, as new Buddhist places of worship come in, have you tried to incorporate something evolutionary in the traditional patterns?
I wish I got the opportunity.
Okay.
But I haven't got the opportunity.
Because you showed us, your line drawings also reflect a lot of the spiritual aesthetics.
So far, you know, there's a lot of politics involved when it comes to building, doing Buddhist
places of worship.
Yeah, places of worship. And, you know, there was a certain serenity about it.
Yeah, so you have to keep very close to the tradition.
But I haven't got that option.
Thank you.
Yes, yes. But most of them are architects, you know, because my studio is an architectural studio. So they go their own way. And very, very few people get involved with the crafts, you know, though they have designed, you know, worked on the tapestries. But, you know, they pursue an architectural career. Yes, sir.
I wonder if you could tell us how the artisans that you've worked with, how do they see their future, or how do their children see their future in Sri Lanka today?
The artisans, the weaving village, which I continue to work with, I had no time to talk about it, you know. But I'm happy to say that young boy, the son of the master weaver has more business than I have, you know. And the day after the opening, the launch of my book, they had to rush back to the village because the older son was opening a new atelier, you know. And he had built a new structure, solid structure, to house about 6 looms. So they are doing pretty well. The Potter village is doing pretty well. So, so I have no official status anymore to work with craftspeople other than, you know, the people I've known and, you know, I continue to work with. My tapestries, I retail them, you know. And the Potter's Village, they have their own sales outlets. There are large pottery stores, and people are moving away from aluminium and all today. So there's a big demand for the handcrafted clay utensils. So that village is doing extremely well, you know. I mean, amazing success. No, they're about 2 hours from Colombo, you know, and they're extreme. I mean, it's quite a success story that village is, you know. I mean, and they're all women potters, amazing, you know, and some of them from that village, she told me, the younger ones had gone out to work in factories. Apparel factories, and after marriage, and once the kids started to come, they got back to their traditional, you know, occupation, and they continue because they're at home then, you know, with the children. So when I intervened, there were 10 women weaving, making pots. Now there are 15 women. So it's. I mean, in this day and age, I think it's quite an achievement for them. You know, I mean, they own, as I said, that lady owns a lorry and a Landmaster tractor. You know, I mean, so her husband is a drunkard. So.
Thank you, Tilak. It was very interesting, I'm sure, for the audience to hear about your work, and. Thank you very much for being here with us today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. And I hope you enjoyed the presentation. I mean, this is my way of paying tribute to Kumar Swami, you know. I mean, the continuity, you know. I mean, thank you. Thank you very much for being here today. Thank you, Your Excellency, for being present here today. Thank you, Ritu. Yes. Thanks a lot. Mm-hmm.